speed as asked me to spill the beans about Lee Bridgeford. He said the video tributes are loaded either with outright lies or gross distortion of facts and embarrassing testaments to the character that portrayed a totally fictional persona. The video tributes are elusive in their praise of what a fine, quiet gentleman he is, how his perfectionism and workaholism produced many achievements and earned plaudits for the ministry, how he went out of his way to help colleagues improve their projects, how he never showed impatience or disgust when dealing with idiots or morons. Pure dribble, says Steve. He contends that nobody knows who Lee Bridgeford is. He wants to ensure that people receive a more balanced, realistic view of the grumpy, moody, mumbling, crotchety old bastard that he worked with for so many years. He does not want him to leave the ministry with a totally fictional persona. So he turned to me to set the record straight. But here it goes. When I was first introduced to Lee on his first day of work at the ministry, I could not understand a fucking word he said. Not one. Lee's speaking style was a mumbled, slow murmur. His ultra-low, quiet, whispery tones were accentuated by a serious, sage, bearded visage. It almost forced listeners to believe his murmurs and mumblings were full of weight, of meaning, of gravada, like he was to be treated like an old Catholic in pointy red shoes. Only intelligent dogs were capable of understanding his soft murmurs and mumblings, but they were incapable of translating his speech to humans. When Lee made presentations at staff meetings, colleagues would shout out, "Speak louder, I can't hear you." These people were sitting 5 feet away from Lee in the front row. The people in the back room thought he was performing a Marcel Mersu pantomime act and would applaud him whenever Lee moved his hands or touched his glasses or walked around the stage like he was performing his soft shoes shuffle. There were only one time I ever understood his mumblings and murmurs. Lee visited me at the hospital at Toronto General a few days after 9/11. I was overdosed on heavy drugs and badly underdosed on nicotine. Lee reeked of cigarette smoke. I thought he was a tobacco tree and I immediately hugged and sniffed him. I would have lit him up if I had my Zippo lighter. "How you feeling, man? I got the original Beatles tape, Sergeant Pepper." For the first time I understood him. "Beatles of gear, man. Thanks, Lee." Mumbles. That became the branch nickname. But nobody called him Mumbles to his face. I'll explain later. Sure, I really liked the guy for the first time I met him and we hit it off. We soon became fast friends. How could you not like the dude? He had style. Clothes daily in black suits, black turtleneck, black sunglasses and cigarettes hanging from his mouth. He was a menacing 50s and 60s cool with a hint of debauchery, shaded and obvious, dissolute, murky past. Lee could easily have passed for a seedy graphic artist type, a public relations man for the mob in Vegas. However, we were all scared of him. We had no idea what he did. He was a webmaster, we were told. A what? What the hell is a webmaster? I looked it up in the dictionary and there wasn't one there. The very word conjured up thoughts of hunchback nasties from the Middle Ages boiling innocents and alive in cauldrons of hot water. Or maybe he was just an evil psychopath who was breeding millions of giant killer spiders to help him take over the world. We just didn't know what to think about him. So I asked around and no one, not even the people with human resources, knew what the webmaster did or why the ministry wanted one. Hadn't we got it pretty good over all these years without a webmaster, we asked. Perhaps the most frightening of all, why is Lee's office larger than the director's? I thought of Butch Cassidy when I asked a colleague, "Just who is this guy?" "He's the webmaster," she cautioned. "When you mumble something only a webmaster can understand, even the director listens, nods his head and tells him to proceed." I asked one of our directors why Lee's office was larger than his. "Because he's the fucking webmaster. I am just a director," he mumbled. "He requires a lot of space to do whatever he does, and I've been told. Who told you? I asked. I can't tell you, it's a government secret, he whispered. Where did he come from? I persisted. I don't know, said the director. They wouldn't tell me. What does the webmaster's office look like? I asked. I don't know, said the director. He wouldn't let me in. Apparently a few years before, the former director did enter the webmaster's office. He was never seen again. My mind thought of giant killer spiders. In summation, this is a story that Steve wanted exposed about the real Lee Bridgeford. He was a guy who nobody understood what he said because he talked in a low mumble. Nobody knew what he did or why the ministry needed a webmaster. Nobody knew where he came from. And nobody knew why he had an office larger than the director's. To complete the mystery surrounding Lee Bridgeford, he had the audacity to steal headlines from the Pope by announcing his retirement at the same time. You have to hand it to the Mumbler in Black. He got away with the gig for more than 20 years. I hope he takes his giant spiders with him. Killer spiders with him, that is.